TV.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content.
LoveLine. Viewer discretion advised.
Is Dr. Drew. He's a board-certified physician. He's addiction medicine specialist and the mother of three.
Father of three, all right.
Oh, yeah, well, you have three kids, either way.
That's about as close as you've come to anything worthwhile, so all right.
Oh, Drew, don't start this early in the show. I'll take you down right here. All right, Drew, what are we trying to accomplish here tonight?
We are trying to learn from the consequences of one's peers' actions.
Right.
That's it.
I want to learn that. I just looked through a Corolla family album. That's how I learn about those consequences. But tonight, from the Tony Rich Project, ladies and gentlemen, Tony Rich is here. Also, we'll be checking in with our lovely LoveLine correspondent in the audience, Chris Magaha. Hi, Chris.
Hey, guys. Good to be here. And, of course, I'm the mother of none.
That'll change for the night's over, baby.
Woo!
All right, and we'll be using the PicTel system going out to Anaheim, California, where they're having this big board fest competition. We'll be taking questions from people out there.
Great.
All right, but let's go to the phone, shall we, Drew?
Beautiful, let's go.
Kim, you're on LoveLine. What's your question?
Hi. I went to Alabama to see my family, and while I was down there, I met a really cute guy. Well, we end up making out very heavily. Nothing past that, nothing past kissing. And later on that week, my grandmother had a family dinner, and at the dinner, the guy walks into the room, and I looked at him, and I said, what are you doing at my grandmother's house? He says, what do you mean? This is my grandmother's house. And, we really like each other, and I'm just wondering what we should do from here.
Wasn't there a Elvis movie about this, Drew?
Yeah, I think so.
Well, it was a true story, so I don't know about Elvis.
are you guys first cousins?
No, we're fourth.
Fourth cousins.
Mm-hmm.
Wait a minute. Is there a fourth cousin, or is that just a stranger at that point? When does it just become an enemy?
That's your sister.
No, but seriously, do you know how many cousins can you go down?
Before what?
I don't know.
Before they're not your cousin anymore.
Well,
I think the concerns with consanguinity are with the first cousin. So anything beyond that, there's not really that big an issue. It could be kind of weird if you get involved with somebody that's in your, no matter how distantly removed, he's really in your immediate family. In the future, when you go to family gatherings or whatnot, if this relationship didn't work out, it'd be kind of awkward.
Yeah.
But, you know, at least they have something in common, like the
grandma.
Parents and stuff.
Like grandma.
I think it generally in families it's important to respect boundaries, and you're kind of flirting with trouble with this kind of thing, and it might work out, it might not. You're gonna have to make that decision. It's something that is risky and could be disruptive to your entire family, really, but it's your decision, Kim.
Fourth cousin, I say go ahead, enjoy.
Yeah. Thanks for your call. Yeah.
If they have kids, is there any danger of the kid coming out looking like Carrot Top having like a big grouper mouth or
not
something?
Not really. I mean, it's first cousins where the concerns are the greatest. So
oh, all right.
It's not that big a deal.
Well, we talked about them a few minutes ago, and now you're going to get to meet him. Ladies and gentlemen, Tony Rich. Joining us, Tony. So the album Words has gone platinum.
Yes.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah, I'm happy about that.
First album gone platinum. Yeah. Tell us, it's kind of a cool story how you got in. Not into the business, but a guy who helped you in.
Well, it kind of goes two ways, I guess. It was John Sally, who at the time was playing with the Detroit Pistons.
Right.
And his hobby was to have, like, studio. So he had a studio, and I kind of met with him. And at that point, that's when I was able to be in a studio and not be charged for it and really get to, you know, to develop. And then that kind of fell apart, and then I met Pebbles, and that's how I wound up at LaFace by
right.
way of Pebbles.
Did you start writing for her first?
Yeah, I came. I went, you know, she flew me down to Atlanta, and I started working on songs for her. And then she introduced me to L.A. At the time, I was her husband, and that's when he signed me to LaFace.
And you then got back, you went recently with Mariah Carey to Europe, right?
Yeah, I did. We did, how many, 4 days, I think.
Playing, like, stadiums and stuff?
Yeah.
How was that, cool. Her screaming all that time?
No, she doesn't scream.
She don't scream when she talks?
She sings like a bird, man. She sounds just like the record. No, she, for real.
Yeah.
She sounds great.
She's good looking, too. I like her.
We've got Giselle in the audience. Let's go.
Giselle, what's your question?
Where is she?
Where are you?
I'm over here.
Oh, feel free to stand up.
Okay. Well, I have this problem, sort of. Here's my situation. Last year I started seeing this guy, and everything was great in the beginning, but then I noticed that all he wanted to do was just jump down my pants, and I have a problem with that because I'm a virgin and I plan on staying that way until I get married.
So you're wearing the pants at the time? I have a problem.
And he knows that was your intention.
He was aware of that. Yeah, he was aware of that, but I guess he still persisted. And that kind of bothered me, so I dumped him. And,
Hey, settle down. Settle down, all you. I'll turn a fire hose on all you.
So, a year went by, and weird enough, I ended up running back into him. And he came up to me, oh, I'm a reformed man, and I don't just want sex, I want you. And I'm like, okay. And I thought, well, maybe there is hope for this guy. And I was like, okay, I'll give him a chance. So, unfortunately, the whole thing happened over again, and I want to know, is there a decent man in this world that doesn't have to revolve the entire relationship around sex? And if there is, where? Where? Hello?
There's a whole bar full of these guys down in Santa Monica. No, please. Please, relax, everyone. Certainly there are guys out there. Drew's this way. Drew, you're not interested in sex at all, are you?
Non-taken men, that is.
Oh, okay. Tony, you know any guys that aren't interested in women that way?
I think it's plenty. I just think that, I think that women are more emotional, and that's not bad at all, but men are generated more by the physical.
I think
this is just a true fact, but not all men are that way. I just think that, you know, the general...
Or that although they may be that way, they are willing to subjugate that for a relationship.
That's true.
And sublimate it and wait and engage in the emotional intimacy first. And that's really, that's very appropriate of you. It's very healthy of you to do that.
Yeah.
So I would say just stay where you are. You will find a guy. And you will probably have much more success in your relationships with the people who go searching around and having instant intimacy.
That's true.
You will have, somebody will come your way. I'm convinced of it.
Yes. You'll be a little past menopause, but don't worry. Come on. Thank you, Giselle. Oh, there's some advice, Drew.
No, no. Not only that, there's a...
Lock yourself in the apartment, draw the drapes, rip the phone out.
If you want to know what's wrong with having physical relationships before it's time, just listen to this show for a little while. All we talk about is people having problems as a result of that.
All right.
Okay.
But we're always talking to women. The guys are all right.
Well, I've got my question. Oh, Greg, what can we do for you?
Hi. Okay, here's the situation. I've been seeing this really nice lady for about 4 months, I'd say. And when it comes to our intimacy, I'd say about 2 times out of 3, when we make love, she kind of breaks wind in the middle of it, you know. And to make matters even worse, she'll act like nothing ever took place, you know.
All right.
So when this happens... It's really difficult for me to get back. I mean, it throws my concentration off, and I'm just out for the count. So how can one get back in the mood following an act like this?
All right, hold on a second there, Greg. He's got himself a whoopee girlfriend is what he's got. Now, wait. We're not going to answer it yet. We're going to take a look at Tony Rich's video, and we're going to go to break.
Tomorrow morning, I'm hitting the dusty road. Gonna find
might go, and I'm gonna load my heart and hope you come back to me.
Back with more Loveline with Tony Rich and the fabulous Dr. Drew. And when we left off, we were speaking to Greg on the fart line. Greg, his problem is his girl, who he loves very much, has a little flatulence problem. But now, Greg, is she farting all day long or just when you guys are in bed?
You know, sometimes I think she waits for us to be making love.
No, you know what? Wait. That ain't right. No, that's not right. You know what? You probably need to find out where the air is coming from.
Oh, Tony. Tony, you've been with a woman before. Dr. Tony's very, very astute, Tony. That's right. Greg, could that be possible?
Well, judging from the smell, I'm pretty positive of where it's coming from.
Okay.
Why would she wait, though?
I'm sorry?
Why would she wait and plan it? This woman is diabolical.
It could be psychological. I don't know, because throughout the day, I don't really, you know, see too much of it. But sometimes when the mood is right, it's right for other things as well.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, sexually, that's kind of a deal breaker. Because the thing about sex is, first, you never want to bust up when you're having sex. You get that serious face on. You know, you get that look of love going. You squint your eyes, and you flare your nostrils a little. You grit your teeth a little bit. And then if someone's going to go ahead and break wind, then that...
I would just start laughing. You know?
Maybe Chris has a moment. We're going to need a lady's point of view on this. Maybe Chris has something to say about it.
Well, this has obviously got to be a problem with nerves. How long have you guys been together?
Approximately 4 months, officially.
So you've been together 4 months officially.
Right.
Well, she can't be in complete denial about this. You guys are acting like she's in complete denial. She has no idea that this is going on. This has got to be a thing where she's, you know, very insecure about it. And to me, I think you need to be extremely sensitive and talk to her about it. I mean, if it's not a situation where you can just laugh it off and you guys kind of laugh and clear the wind, I mean, or whatever, and, you know, and then go back to what you were doing. I think that you just need to be, obviously, you know, she knows this is going on, you need to be extremely sensitive and just talk to her about this.
Greg.
Yes.
If it was me, that's what I would want.
Has she ever, has ever been so bad where she, like, set off the smoke detector in the room?
Not yet, but I wouldn't put it past her.
Well, it also could be a very passive-aggressive thing that she's doing.
She's acting out.
It could be.
Her rear end is acting out. You may be right, awesome. Drew.
I like Chris's advice. Let's hope she's that kind of person.
All right, Greg, okay? One word, Beano. Okay. Catherine, you're on the Loveline phone. What is your question?
Hi.
Hey.
Well, I've been dating my boyfriend for about 11 months. And we haven't had sex for, like, almost 2 months now. And I don't know if he's cheating on me or if it's like the pot he smokes every day. So my question is does heavy pot smoking lessen your sex drive?
Absolutely. Especially in young males, it can actually increase estrogen levels, decrease testosterone levels, decrease sperm count. It can make him depressed, and that can further decrease sex drive. So if he's a heavy daily pot smoker, that could be the whole thing. And does he have a family history of alcoholism, do you know?
Actually, yeah.
So he's a true marijuana addict, and this isn't going to stop unless he gets some treatment. There is a syndrome of marijuana addiction, and it happens only in the setting of alcoholism, and he has that family history, so he has that biological makeup in all probability.
Right.
And he's now having consequences from his marijuana smoking, and it's affecting his relationships, affecting his health, and you got to confront him like crazy about this. He's gonna fight.
Drew,
Chris.
I mean, don't you think she needs to confront the idea about the cheating, too, because she said that she wasn't sure whether or not he was cheating or not as well?
He's
too lazy to cheat. He wanted to cheat, but he thought he'd watch a little more Saved by the Bell, the college years, and have another bucket of Cheetos.
And Adam is right. There's truly an amotivational syndrome associated with marijuana, and that makes cheating less likely. Also, addicts lie, so if she confronts him about it, he's less likely to tell her exactly what's going on. Catherine, the deal is just confront him about the consequences here and ask him to do something about this, okay?
Right, thank
All right.
you.
Good luck.
She has her work cut out for her.
Oh, yeah.
Drew, because this once you get in this whole sort of Hesher thing, it is a lifestyle.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
It's a religion.
There's all this denial, cultural denial. People, you know, it's a natural herb, it's okay, it's good. For some people, it causes serious addiction. And, culture be damned, it's a problem.
Risa, you're on the LoveLine phone. What is your question?
Well, I've been with my boyfriend for 2 years, and last week when he was masturbating, he noticed blood in his semen. And afterward, when he would urinate, it would stink. So I was just curious, and I just wanted to know, you know, what this could be, if it could be an STD or what it possibly could be.
Probably the reason it stung when he urinated was because the blood can actually irritate the urethral tract, the part that the urine comes out of, mm-hmm. and can cause that stinging sensation. Mm-hmm. Blood in the sperm, in the semen, is actually not that uncommon a thing. You might be surprised to find
really?
Out. Yeah.
Really?
And it is rather unusual that it would be anything serious.
Mm-hmm.
It can be a sign of infection, both in the prostate or other parts of the male genital tract.
Mm-hmm.
It could be associated with a sexually transmitted disease, though not very likely, frankly.
Okay.
He should see a doctor, obviously have cultures done, be checked to make sure there's not something unusual like a tumor, which would be very, very unusual.
Mm-hmm.
So the probability is it's nothing to be certainly alarmed about. It's probably not a sexually transmitted disease, but it does need to be checked out for these things, as they can cause this sort of thing very unusually.
Well, how do they check it? What do they do?
Probably what they'll just do is do a urinalysis on him and just do a physical exam.
Okay, is there any way he can send something in?
No. He has to present himself in all his glory.
He can't put something through a hole in the wall or something?
No, Adam, he can't.
All right. Well, to me, it's very embarrassing to have...
I can imagine.
I went to a free clinic one time. I was nothing but ladies, and the pants were around the ankles for a good 2 hours. And
tell me more.
Well, you know, we've talked about this before. You doctors, your favorite thing to do is tell people to strip down and sit. Meanwhile, you're conducting tours of the hospital. And have a... There's a group from the senior citizens home coming through at noon. They have a Girl Scout jamboree coming through there. Meanwhile, your pants are around your ankles.
What were you there for?
I had a little yeasty thing that I'd contracted somewhere. And anyway, there it was. And these women are having this conversation while my, you know, pants are around my ankles. It's very humiliating, of course. I didn't want to interrupt them. I was scared they might give me like a karate chop or something. JC in the LoveLine bar, where are you?
Right here.
What is your question?
Well, my situation is I've been dating this man for about 8 months now. He's straight, has a girlfriend and a baby. 2 weeks before his baby was born, he comes to me and says, it's over. We can, you know, be friends and talk. So I'm saying that's cool. I can handle that. 2 weeks after his baby was born, he comes to me and asking for the relationship again. 2 times after that, he cuts me off totally. We haven't talked in a week now. And my question is, why am I attracted to straight guys that are obviously bisexual and afraid to come out of the closet? And why can't I be with somebody that's out and proud to be what they are?
All right, well, he may have a straight life, but I guarantee he's a little bent.
Oh, I know this.
I mean, because if you're having a relationship with a man, you can't be a straight man having a gay relationship, can you?
Yeah, I mean, I suspect he's not even bisexual. He's probably just homosexual, but having real difficulty dealing with that. He's obviously ambivalent about his relationship with you. He has guilt and all kinds of confusion about his sexual orientation. But really, that's not your question. Your question is not about him. Your question is about yourself and why you tend to go for these unavailable guys.
Yes.
Have you ever been severely hurt in relationships in the past?
Yes, I have.
And, I mean, to me, it seems like a safe place to go where you can't really achieve any kind of intimacy, right? I mean, these guys really don't even know if they're gay or not. They're kind of in and out. And you never really get to the point of intimacy. So how can you experience loss with somebody you've never been really connected with?
Oh, Drew.
That hurt.
He cuts right to the quick, doesn't he?
No, but I mean, that's the fact.
True. It's true.
And you know, that's where you're at right now. I mean, if you want to be honest with yourself and actually have an intimate relationship, try to wade into a relationship, you know, take yourself in and try to keep your anxiety to a minimum and see
right,
how it
so,
feels.
Drew, let me paraphrase here because you're lulling the audience
It's like women that date married men. Same idea.
Right.
Same idea.
You intentionally pursue people, and it's also like a lot of guys who date, you know, like when I was in high school, I was going after the head cheerleader. Now, I should have been going after one of the women who worked in the lunchroom, but, you know, the hairnet in her 70s. I was doing this. It was just a distraction. I was never going to be able to get her.
Right.
And so what you're saying is people that go after the sort of inaccessible relationships
right.
are really just avoiding intimacy.
Absolutely.
Because they're never going to have a relationship with this person.
And, you know...
It was like when I was stalking Engelbert Humperdinck for a while. I was...
That's like... Same idea. All right, thanks for...
We could never be together.
Thanks for your call, your question, Jesse. Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Good luck.
Let's go to the LoveLine phone.
Candace.
Yeah.
All right, what can we do for you?
Huh?
Well, how can we help you, Candace?
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, I lost my virginity to my boyfriend of 1 year. And within that 1 year, we only had sex about 3 times. And it's very, very painful. I hate it. It hurts. It feels like he's tearing me apart, and it burns. And I ask him, is it supposed to hurt? And he says, yes, but, you know, I thought sex was supposed to be pleasurable. So my question is something wrong with me?
You've never had sex before?
No, he's the first person I've been with.
Why do you hesitate about that?
Why did I hesitate about, is he the first person I had sex with?
Yes.
Well,
because he's in the room, that's why.
No, I'm just joking. well, it's just the hesitation. I can barely hear you.
Okay, Drew.
The most common reason for somebody your age to have pain with intercourse is actually muscle spasm and what's something called vaginismus, which is usually due to some anxiety or some conflict about being sexually active. Obviously, you've got to see a doctor to make sure that things are anatomically okay, make sure you don't have any infections because those can also cause pain. But the most common reason is the muscle spasm and the fact that you hesitated in answering that question about whether or not you previously had sex. You know, it causes me to worry that maybe something can happen to you earlier, and that's why you have a lot of anxiety about having sex.
Candace, anything in the past?
No, he's the first one.
All right, well then see a doctor, get checked out, and then you've got to figure out ways to kind of relax in this situation. Maybe this isn't the right relationship, maybe you're not ready for this with this guy, or are you ready for it at all?
Right.
So get seen, and then try to relax, okay?
Okay.
Fabulous LoveLine episode put to bed. Thank you, Dr. Drew. Thank you, Tony Rich. Got himself a CD out called Words. I suggest you go get it if you haven't already gotten it. Chris Magaha, thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.